The Autobiography of Benjamin Franklin, Appendix. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. The Autobiography of Benjamin Franklin, edited by Frank Woodward Pine. Appendix. Electrical Kite. To Peter Collinson, Philadelphia, October 19, 1752. Sir, as frequent mention is made in public papers from Europe of the success of the Philadelphia experiment for drawing the electric fire from clouds by means of pointed rods of iron erected on high buildings, etc., it may be agreeable to the curious to be informed that the same experiment has succeeded in Philadelphia, though made in a different and more easy manner, which is as follows. Make a small cross of two light strips of cedar, the arm so long as to reach to the four corners of a large, thin, silk handkerchief, then extend it. Tie the corners of the handkerchief to the extremities of the cross, so you have the body of a kite, which, being properly accommodated with a tail, loop, and string, will rise in the air, like those made of paper, but this, being of silk, is fitter to bear the wet and wind of a thunder gust without tearing. To the top of the upright stick of the cross is to be fixed a very sharp pointed wire, rising a foot or more above the wood. To the end of the twine, next the hand, is to be tied a silk ribbon, and where the silk and twine join, a key may be fastened. This kite is to be raised when a thunder gust appears to be coming on, and the person who holds the string must stand within a door or window or under some cover, so that the silk ribbon may not be wet, and care must be taken that the twine does not touch the frame of the door or window. As soon as any of the thunderclouds come over the kite, the pointed wire will draw the electric fire from them, and the kite with all the twine will be electrified, and the loose filaments of the twine will stand out every way and be attracted by an approaching finger. And when the rain has wet the kite and twine so that it can conduct electric fire freely, you will find it streams out plentifully from the key on the approach of your knuckle. As this key, the file may be charged, and from electric fire thus obtained, spirits may be kindled, and all the electric experiments be performed, which are usually done by the help of a rubbed glass globe or tube, and thereby the sameness of the electric matter with which that of lightning completely demonstrated. B. Franklin. The shade of him who counsel can bestow, still pleased to teach, and yet not proud to know, unbiased, or by favor, or by spite, nor dully prepossessed, nor blindly right, who learned well-bred, and though well-bred, sincere, modestly bold, and humanely severe, who to a friend his faults can sweetly show, and gladly praise the merit of a foe. Here, there, he sits, he is cheerful aid to lend, a firm, unshaken, uncorrupted friend, averse alike to flatter or offend. He rarely warm in censure or in praise. Good nature, wit, and judgment round him wait, and thus he sits enthroned in classic state. To failings mild, but zealous for desert, the clearest head and sincerest heart, few men deserve our passion either ways. From Father Abraham's Speech, 1760. End of Electrical Kite. The Way to Wealth. From Father Abraham's Speech, forming the preface to Poor Richard's Almanac for 1758. It would be thought a hard government that should tax its people 1/10 part of their time to be employed in its service, but idleness taxes many of us much more, if we reckoned all that is spent in absolute sloth, or doing of nothing, with that which is spent in the employments or amusements that amount to nothing. Sloth, by bringing on disease, absolutely shortens life. Sloth, like rust, consumes faster than labor wears, while the used key is always bright, as poor Richard says. But dost thou love life? Then do not squander time, for that's the stuff life is made of, as poor Richard says. How much more than is necessary do we spend in sleep, forgetting that the sleeping fox catches no poultry, and that there will be sleeping enough in the grave, as poor Richard says. If time be of all things, the most precious wasting time must be, as poor Richard says, the greatest fragility, since, as he elsewhere tells us, lost time is never found again, and what we call time enough always proves little enough. Let us then up and be doing, and doing to the purpose, so by diligence shall we do more with less perplexity. Sloth makes all things difficult, but industry all easy, as poor Richard says, and he that riseth late must trod all day, and shall scarce overtake his business at night, while laziness travels so slowly that poverty soon overtakes it, as we read in poor Richard, who adds, "Drive thy business, let not that drive thee," and early to bed and early to rise makes a man healthy, wealthy, and wise. Industry need not wish, and he that lives upon hope will die fasting. There's no gains without pains. He that hath a trade hath an estate, and he that hath a calling hath an office of profit and honor. But then the trade must be worked, and the calling well formed, for neither the estate nor the office will enable us to pay our taxes. What though you have found no treasure, nor has any such relation left you a legacy? Diligence is the mother of good luck, as poor Richard says, and God gives all things to industry. One today is worth two tomorrow, and farther. Have you something to do tomorrow, do it today. If you were a servant, you would not be ashamed that a good master should catch you idle. Are you, then, your own master? Be ashamed to catch yourself idle. Stick to it steadily, and you will see great effects, for constant dropping wears away stones, and by diligence and patience the mouse ate into the cable, and little strokes fell great oaks. Methinks I hear some of you say, "Must a man afford himself no leisure?" I will tell thee, my friend, what poor Richard says. Employ thy time well, if thou meanest to gain leisure, and since thou art not sure of a minute, throw not away an hour. Leisure is time for doing something useful. This leisure the diligent man will obtain, but the lazy man never, so that, as poor Richard says, a life of leisure and a life of laziness are two things. Keep thy shop, and thy shop will keep thee, and again, if you would have your business done, go, if not, send. If you would have a faithful servant, and one you like, serve yourself. A little neglect may breed great mischief, adding, for want of a nail, the shoe was lost, for want of a shoe, the horse was lost, and for want of a horse, the rider was lost, being overtaken and slain by the enemy, all for the want of care about a horseshoe nail. So much for industry, my friends, and attention to one's own business. But to these we must add frugality. What maintains one vice would bring up two children. You may think, perhaps, that a little tea or a little punch now and then, diet a little more costly, clothes a little finer, and a little entertainment now and then, can be no great matter. But remember what poor Richard says, many a little makes a mickle. Beware of little expenses. A little leak will sink a great ship. And again, who dainties love shall beggars prove, and moreover, fools make feasts, and wise men eat them. But what thou hast no need of, and ere long thou shalt sell thy necessaries. If you would know the value of money, go and try to borrow some, for he that goes a-borrowing goes a-sorrowing. The second vice is lying, the first is running in debt. Lying rides upon debt's back, Poverty often deprives a man of all spirit and virtue. 'Tis hard for an empty bag to stand upright. And now, to conclude, experience keeps a dear school, but fools will learn in no other, and scare in that, for it is true, we may give advice, but we cannot give conduct, as poor Richard says. However, remember this, they that won't be counseled can't be helped, as poor Richard says, and farther, that if you will not hear reason, she'll surely rap your knuckles. The Whistle to Madame Brillion, Passé, November 10th, 1779. I am charmed with your description of paradise, and with your plan of living there, and I approve much of your conclusion, that in the meantime we should draw all the good we can from this world. In my opinion, we might all draw more good from it than we do, and suffer less evil, if we should take care not to give too much for whistles, for to me it seems that most of the unhappy people we meet with are come to by neglect of that caution. You ask what I mean? You love stories, and will excuse my telling one of myself. When I was a child of 7 years old, my friends, on a holiday, filled my pockets with coppers. I went directly to a shop where they sold toys for children, and being charmed with the sound of a whistle that I met by the way in the hands of another boy, I voluntarily offered and gave all my money for one. I then came home and went whistling all over the house, much pleased with my whistle, but disturbing all the family. My brothers and sisters and cousins, understanding the bargain I had made, told me I had given four times as much for it as it was worth, put me in mind of what good things I might have bought with the rest of the money, and laughed at me so much for my folly that I cried with vexation, and the reflection gave me more chagrin than the whistle gave me pleasure. This, however, was afterwards of use to me, the impression continuing on my mind, so that often when I was tempted to buy some unnecessary thing, I said to myself, "Don't give too much for the whistle," and I saved my money. As I grew up, came into the world, and observed the actions of men, I thought I met with many, very many, who gave too much for the whistle. When I saw one too ambitious for court favors, sacrificing his time and attendance on levees, his repose, his liberty, his virtue, and perhaps his friends, to attain it, I have said to myself, "This man gives too much for his whistle." When I saw another, fond of popularity, constantly employing himself in political bustles, neglecting his own affairs and ruining them by neglect, "He pays indeed," said I, "too much for his whistle." If I knew a miser who gave up every kind of comfortable living, all the pleasure of doing good to others, all the esteem of his fellow citizens, and the joys of benevolent friendship, for the sake of accumulating wealth, "Poor man," said I, "you pay too much for your whistle." When I met with a man of pleasure, sacrificing every laudable improvement of the mind, or of his fortune, to mere corporal sensations, and ruining his health in the pursuit, "Mistaken man," said I, "you are providing pain for yourself instead of pleasure, you give too much for your whistle." If I see one fond of appearance, or fine clothes, fine houses, fine furniture, fine equipages, all above his fortune, for which he contracts debts and ends his career in a prison, "Alas," say I, "he paid dear, very dear, for his whistle." When I see a beautiful, sweet-tempered girl, married to an ill-natured brute of a husband, "What a pity," say I, "that she should pay so much for a whistle." In short, I conceive that the great part of the miseries of mankind are brought upon them by the false estimates they have made of the value of things, and by their giving too much for their whistles. Yet I ought to have charity for these unhappy people when I consider that, with all this wisdom of which I am boasting, there are certain things in the world so tempting, for example, the apples of King John, which happily are not to be bought, for they were put to sale by auction, I might very easily be led to ruin myself in the purchase and find that I had once more given too much for the whistle. Adieu, my dear friend, and believe me ever yours very sincerely, with unalterable affection, B. Franklin. A Letter to Samuel Mather, Passé, May 12, 1784. Reverend Sir, It is now more than 60 years since I left Boston, but I remember well both your father and grandfather, having heard them both in the pulpit and seen them in their houses. The last time I saw your father, it was the beginning of 1724, when I visited him after my first trip to Pennsylvania. He received me in his library, and on taking leave, showed me a shorter way out of the house through a narrow passage, which was crossed by a beam overhead. We were still talking as I withdrew. He accompanied me behind, and I turned partly towards him, when he said hastily, "Stoop, stoop." I did not understand him, till I felt my head hit against the beam. He was a man that never missed an occasion of giving instruction, and upon this he said to me, "You are young, and have the world before you. Stoop, as you go through it, and you will miss many hard thumps." This advice, thus beat into my head, has frequently been of use to me, and I often think of it when I see pride mortified and misfortunes brought upon people by their carrying their heads too high. B. Franklin. The End. End of Appendix. End of The Autobiography of Benjamin Franklin.